I'm going to be in John chapter 4 today, if you want to go ahead and open up your Bibles to John chapter 4. You know, a simple gospel presentation is very straightforward and from the Bible, and we learn these, and we've started to learn them since we were kids, if you've been in church since you were a kid. But to really try to invite someone to come and to give their life to Christ, to try to tell them what's going to happen or even how to do it, is difficult to put into words. And the reason it's difficult to put into words is because it's a spiritual event, and it's something that happens spiritually. It happens inside of you, and it's something that God does. God initiates it, and God does it, and God sees it through to the end. And so it's very difficult, I guess, and maybe it's not. Maybe for you it's not. But it's difficult to explain. But today, I very honestly and truthfully and straightforwardly, I want to invite you to give your life to Jesus and to give your life to Christ. And I want to try to tell you why. I want to try to say what the difference it's going to make. But I'm going to unapologetically today to ask you and invite you to surrender your life and to give your life to Christ. And I'm going to do it using this story in John chapter 4 of the woman at the well. And if you don't mind, I'm just going to kind of tell it instead of reading it. Jesus was on his way toward Galilee, and he had to go through the town of Samaria. And so as he went through Samaria, it was hot, and they came to a water well. The water wells were outside of the town, and the people would come and draw water from the water wells. And he sat down. The disciples went into a town to find something to eat. And as he was sitting there, this lady comes to draw water. She's alone. She's by herself. And he just says to her, he says, you know, give me a drink. And she responds, she says, you know, how is it that you're a man and a Jew, and you're going to ask me, a Samaritan woman, for a drink? Now, there was a little, obviously, by the way she responded, you get the feeling that there was just some tension between Jews and Samaritans. They had different thoughts. They had different ideas. They were a little different. And first of all, in that culture, men didn't talk to women anyhow, publicly. They just didn't do that. And then for a Jewish man to be talking to a Samaritan woman, it was a no-no. It was taboo. And so she says, why are you even asking me for a drink of water? And then Jesus says to her, in verse 10, he says, well, if you knew the gift of God and you knew who it is that says to you, give me a drink, then you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. In other words, Jesus says to you, if you knew who I was, you'd be asking me for a drink, and I'd be giving you living water. And so she says, the well is deep, and you don't have anything to even draw water out with. How are you going to get this living water? How are you going to get it for me? She does this other little thing in verse 12. She says, and I'm going to point it out because I'm going to make reference to it later. She says, are you greater than our father Jacob, our patriarch Jacob, who gave us this well, who drank from it on his own, and he watered his livestock here? And now Jacob was a person both Jews and Samaritans were part of their spiritual legacy. And she says, are you greater than him? And Jesus said, well, I'm going to tell you what. He says, he didn't say, I'm going to tell you what. He might have. I don't. He could have. If he'd have been a redneck, that's what he'd have said. He said, I'm going to tell you what. He said, whoever drinks from this water right here, as he points to the well, he said, they're going to get thirsty again. He said, but if you drink of the water that I can give, that it will become inside of you a fountain of water that is springing up into everlasting life. And so she says, well, give me some. She says, I want some. She says, give me some of this water. And he says, well, go call your husband. And she's like, oh, that's a problem. She said, I don't have a husband. And he says, I know. You've said correctly you don't have a husband. He said, in fact, you've had five husbands. And the man that you're with now isn't even one of your husbands. And so then she said, well, you must be a prophet. What gave her that idea? She said, you know, our fathers, our patriarchs, they worshiped on this mountain. But you Jews, y'all say that we have to worship in Jerusalem. And Jesus said, let me tell you something. He said, the day's coming. He said, in fact, now is the time where it's not worshiping on this mountain or it's not worshiping in Jerusalem. He says, the Father is looking for people who are going to worship him in spirit and in truth. So she says, well, I know that the Messiah is coming. She says, I know that the Christ is coming, the Messiah, the one who comes from God. I know that he's coming. And when he gets here, he's going to explain all this to us. And Jesus says, I'm him. He said, the one that speaks to you is he. He says, I am the Messiah. I am the Christ. I am the one who has come from God. He says, that is me. So then it's at this point, the disciples get back. The lady turns and just runs back to town. She leaves her water pot there at the well. She just turns and she runs back to town. I want to read a few verses at this point, starting in verse 27. And she says, at this point, his disciples came and they marveled that he talked with a woman. And yet no one said, what do you seek or why are you talking with her? The woman left her water pot and went her way into the city and said to the men, she said, come see a man who told me all the things that I ever did. Could this be the Christ? So then they went out of the city and they came to him. In the meantime, his disciples urged him, saying, Rabbi, eat. And he said to them, I have food that you don't know of. And the disciples said to one another, has anyone brought him something to eat? And Jesus said to him, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. He said, don't say that there are still 4 months and then the harvest will come. Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, for they are already white for harvest. And he who reaps receives wages, and he who gathers fruit for eternal life, that both he who sows and he who reaps may rejoice together. For in this the saying is true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you have not labored. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labors. So many of the Samaritans of the city believed in him because of the words of the woman who testified, he told me all that I ever did. And when the Samaritans had come to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed with her 2 more days. And many more believed because of his own word. And then they said to the woman, now we believe, not because of what you said, for we ourselves have heard him, and we know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world. So I'm asking you today to take a drink of the living water. Jesus said, if you knew who I was, you'd be asking me for a drink, and I'd be giving you living water, and it would be springing up inside of you into eternal life. And so what I'm asking you today is to give your life to Christ in a way that you will experience eternal life. Now, I need to tell you something biblically. Eternal life is not just Jesus says it's living water. He says, you're going to take a drink of the water that I'm going to give you. It's going to be living water. Here's what I want you to know. Eternal life isn't just heaven after we die. Eternal life starts right now. Eternal life starts in your life right now. And it starts in your heart right now. There is something that happens inside of you right now. Eternal life is not something that you wait on. It's not something that you have to die to obtain. Eternal life is the fountain of living waters that springs up inside of you the moment that you give your life to Christ, the moment that you surrender your life to Him. That springs up. He says it is eternal. It is living water. It is a spring. He says it springs up and it flows inside of you. And the reference He's making is to a spring that is always bubbling up water. It starts right now. It starts bubbling up right now. Eternal life is something that's inside of you. It starts in the here and it starts in the now. Isaiah chapter 58, verse 11, he says, the Lord will guide you continually. Listen to this. He will satisfy your soul in the drought and He will strengthen your bones, and you will be like a watered garden and like a spring of waters, whose waters do not fail. Here's what I want you to know and understand, that when you give your life to Christ, there is something that happens in you spiritually. It starts the minute you give your life to Christ, and it does not end. It does not end until the day you die, and it really doesn't end the day you die, because in the day that you die, you go to be with the Lord and you receive the eternal weight. But what I want you to understand is that there is something about the life that you live. There is something about the quality of the life that you live. There is something about the peace, and there is something about the way that you face life every day from the moment that Christ comes into your life. He talks here in Isaiah about it. You're always being, he can satisfy your soul in the drought. Let me tell you something. In case you were wondering, in case you're young, in case you're just graduating, and you haven't experienced it yet, just ask some of these gray hairs. You're going to go through periods in your life that's going to feel like a drought. You're going to go through periods in your life where you're going to feel alone. You're going to go through periods in your life where you're going to feel abandoned. You're going to go through periods in your life where you're going to feel like there is nothing keeping you alive, where there is nothing that you are able to draw in. And listen, here's what he says. He says, but when you have this spring of living water that is springing up inside of you, that even in the drought, you are going to be able to find a satisfied and afflicted in your afflicted soul. You are going to be satisfied and watered even in the drought. God is able to satisfy your soul. And what he's saying here is, when life gets tough and when life gets hard and when life gets dry, you are going to have the ability to face this life, because you're going to have this spring that's springing up inside of you into eternal life. You're going to have eternal life that's inside of you, not something that you've got a ticket for that you're going to get later on. It's already going to be inside of you. You are already going to have life with God and life with Christ, and it's going to be like that. It will strengthen your bones. You'll be like a watered garden. One of the things that I've learned about gardening, you know, there are some people that make gardening look so easy, right? Right? They just make it look so easy. But there is one critical element to gardening: water. I have this plant in my office, and it almost died one time. It was Cheryl's fault, but I won't say that. It almost died one time, and her mother brought it back to life. And I said, well, I want to take it to my office. And she said, Keith, just water it. Just water it. I said, okay, well, how much? She said, water it every day. And I was thinking, that's crazy. I water this thing every day. Man, I got me a beautiful plant. I really don't water it every day, but I really try to, but I really don't. But I water it several times a week. You know, water is just, you know, you want to be like a watered garden. You want to be like a garden that has beautiful, plush, green plants. You want to be like a garden that is able to produce fruits, and not only able to produce fruits, but a watered garden which actually is producing fruits. Let me tell you something. That is only going to come in your life when you have the living water that is springing up inside of you into eternal life. It's only going to happen when you come to Christ and when you give your life to Christ and He gives you the living water that He has to offer. So look, there's a I'm gonna play on something here, and you don't have to like it if you don't want to, but I'm just gonna do it anyhow. But I'm telling you up front that I'm taking a little play on something. So he says that spring, it's gonna be like a spring, it's gonna be springing up. What's the exact words that he uses? Whoever drinks this water, verse 14, but the water that I give him will be in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. So the word springing up is actually a word and a concept that's used somewhere else. It's used in Acts chapter 3, and it's verse 8, and it's when Peter and John were going to the temple, and they saw the crippled man there, and he was asking for alms, and Peter said, you know, silver and gold I don't have, but what I do have I give to you. And he reached down and he took him by the hand and he said, now get up and walk. And it says that the man, in verse 8, it said that he leaped up. Same words of the well of living water springing up. So the jump I'm taking here, but don't think I'm jumping all this way. The living water, there is a healing that happens. Now, when I say a healing, I'm not talking necessarily about being crippled and being healed. I'm talking about there is a healing that happens in your soul. You see, you know what your problem is? You know that you can never find this, you can never be happy about anything. You can never find any contentment with anything. There's always something wrong. You're always angry. There's always seems to be this darkness that's hovering over you. You know what the problem is? Here's the problem. Inside in your spirit, you're broke. Now, you didn't do anything to break yourself, so it's not blame you. I'm not trying to put that on you. We were born that way. We're broke in our spirits and in our souls. We are broke. We're broken. We are separated from God. We are not who God wants us to be. We are not who God created us to be. We are not who God desired us to be. We have chosen sin. We have chosen to move ourselves away from God. And what we need is we need that brokenness to be fixed. We need that broken spirit to be healed. And that's what the living water does inside of you. It heals your spirit. It makes your spirit whole. It makes your soul well. It makes you alive on the inside. And no matter what happens, I say this all the time, there's no guarantee that your life may not change. Your life may not change at all. Your life won't change at all. But what's going to change is you. What's going to change is your spirit. What's going to change is your heart. And what's going to change is your ability to walk through this life and to face this life, or faith this life, whichever one we want to use. It's your ability to go through and to faith. It's your ability, because you're going to have this relationship with God, this eternal life, this spring that is springing up inside of you into eternal life. It's going to be inside of you. There is a healing for your soul. I need you to know that. I need you to know there is a healing for your soul. And you don't have to walk around in this anger and in this hatred. And you don't have to live your life in this darkness and in this emotional oppression that is upon you. There is a healing for our soul. And it is in the living water that is only found in Christ. I want to invite you today. Listen, I ask you today if you would just come and take a little drink. If you would just come and take a drink. Ask Jesus to give you some of that living water. You know, Philippians 4:13 is a verse. It's a real popular verse, right? I mean, it's a verse. I bet every kid that sat down here on the front row knows Philippians 4:13. I've seen people put it on their letter jackets. I've seen people tattoo it on their bodies, you know, whatever, wherever they do, I don't know. But, you know, Philippians 4:13 is a very popular, very famous verse that everybody uses. And the verse says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, right? But here's what I want to challenge you to do today. Well, no, here's what I'm going to do today. I'm going to actually take that verse and put it in its context. That verse may not mean exactly what you think it means. We use it to say, I can do anything I want to do because I have the power of God and the strength of Christ that's inside of me. But listen to this. This is what Paul writes, starting in verse 11. He says, not that I speak in regard to need, because I have learned in whatever state I am, there to be content. He says, I know how to be abased. In other words, I know how to be at the low, low, low. And he says, and I know how to abound. Everywhere in all things, I have learned to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. What he's saying here is, it doesn't matter what life throws at me. It doesn't matter if I'm on top of the world, or it doesn't matter if I'm laying down in a mud pole. It doesn't matter if I've got plenty to eat. It doesn't matter if I've got nothing to eat. It doesn't matter if I'm up. It doesn't matter if I'm down. The fact of the matter is, I'm going to read between the lines a little bit, and I'm going to make it fit my sermon. He says, the fact of the matter is that because I have the living water of Christ springing up inside of me, I can face every situation that life brings at me and that comes at me in this life. And I have learned in every one of those situations, I have learned how to find contentment. I have learned how to find peace. I have learned how to be at peace when I've got everything going my way, and I've learned how to be at peace when nothing is going my way. I've learned how to be at peace and contentment up here. I've learned how to be at peace and contentment down here. And it's all because, and now I'm connecting it back here, and it's all because I have the living water of Christ that is springing up inside of me into eternal life. Would you take a drink? I mean, would you just try? You know, the lady, the woman at the well, look, she met Jesus. And all she knew was, I'm going to put it in maybe in our vernacular or in a way that you might understand with what you're facing in life. All she knew was, this might be the answer. This really might be the Messiah. This really might be the Christ. She didn't know any theology. She didn't understand anything spiritually, really. And she just ran back to town. And she said, y'all come see a guy who told me everything that I ever did. I want to invite you to just come and see. To just take a drink. To just surrender your life to Christ and give him your life and just see. Just see if he's not the answer. There are some things. Yeah, there are some things. There are some things you're going to have to put out of your mind. And the first one I put, and I'm saying it wrong, I'm sure, but as I describe it, maybe you'll understand. I said you're going to have to forget societal norms. I don't know if that's really the correct way for me to say it, but here's what I mean by that. So she's talking to Jesus, and so the first thing she does, she said, well, you know, Jacob, the great patriarch Jacob, gave us this well. He drank from it himself, and his cattle drank from it as well. This well is special. So, I mean, are you greater than Jacob? Listen, this is where I'm going with this. I want you to know that you are not a Christian because you are an American. We're just going to bring it on down the line. You are not a Christian because you belong to a certain political party. I got one amen. Thank you, Cody. You are not a Christian because grandma and grandpa were godly people. You are not a Christian because mom and dad were charter members of a church. You are not a Christian because of societal things or because of anything in your heritage. You are only a Christian if you yourself take a drink from the living water that Christ is offering to you. You're going to have to put away those things that, well, I'm this or I'm that. Let me tell you something. Until you drink from the water, the only thing you are is broke from the inside out. And what we need is a drink. She left the water pot. She just left it. I thought she was thirsty. I thought she needed some water. Well, she probably did. She probably still needed some water, but suddenly it wasn't as important. She was an outcast. I didn't really point that out, but if you've heard this story before, you know it's been pointed out. She was an outcast. She was coming to the well by herself. She had been married 5 times, and she was living with a man. Look, you know, you might get talked about today. Imagine if you were 2,000 years ago, right? And you had been married 5 times and you were living with a man. Look, she was an outcast. She was an outsider. No one wanted to be around her. No one wanted to be seen talking, except the men, of course. But no one wanted to be around her or be seen talking to her. She was an outcast. Suddenly, she didn't care. She runs back down Main Street saying, y'all need to come and see this guy. Y'all need to come and meet this man, this guy who told me everything that I ever did. You know what else you're going to have to put behind? You're going to have to put behind you, if you don't know Christ, you're going to have to put behind you your religious biases. Is that a good word? Religion. Let's just say religion. You're going to have to put religion behind you. So she starts saying, right, well, we say that we're supposed to worship up on this mountain, but you say that we're supposed to worship. What are we supposed to do? What is the right thing to do? And Jesus says, it ain't either one. It's not in the mountain. It's not in Jerusalem. It's about what's in your heart. Here's what I want you to understand today. I am not inviting. You know what? I'm not inviting you to join our church. I want you to know that. Today, you cannot join our church today. That's actually a lie. You can join our church today. But my point is, I am not asking you to become a Baptist. I am not asking you to join the First Baptist Church. What I am asking you to do is to give your life to Christ and take a drink from the living water so that he can change you from the inside out. That's what I am inviting you to do, and that's what I am asking you to do today. If you don't like, the preaching's terrible at this church, I get it. There's churches down the road, right? No, I get it. I get it. You know, this, whatever. I don't care what church you join. What I care about is whether or not you have Christ in your life. Jesus said it's not about where you worship on that mountain or down in Jerusalem. He says it's about whether or not you take a drink from me. So the disciples are all standing around him. And I know. I'm sorry. So the disciples are all standing around him, and he's trying to impress upon them the urgency. And I also want you to know that after she said to all the men, you need to come and see, it says that they all started going out to the well. They all started running out to Jesus. And so Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he says, you know, don't say there's still 4 months and then the harvest. Maybe as they looked at the fields, maybe they were still 4 months away from the harvest. He said, well, don't be saying there's still 4 months away and then the harvest. He says, look at the fields. And I think he was telling them to look at not the physical agricultural fields. Wouldn't it be something if he had them looking up the road at all those people who are coming down the road out of the city? And he said, look at the fields. He says, they are ready for a harvest right now. One of the things that God has impressed upon me recently is how we are so surrounded by people that are hurting. And we are so surrounded. Listen, we're hurting, right? It's not just, it's right in here. We are so surrounded by people who are hurting and people who need to take a drink of the living water. And it's urgent. It's not, well, maybe sometime down the future. It's right now. It's right now. In John chapter 1, so John the Baptist is standing with some of his disciples, and He points to Jesus and he says, there's the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And this is in John chapter 1, verse 39. And so a little bit later, those two disciples are following Jesus. And he turns around and goes, what do you want? And they're like, where do you stay? I think he caught them off guard. Well, where do you stay? And you know what he said? He said, come see. Come and see. A little bit later, Philip met Christ, and he went and he found Nathanael. And he said, I need you to come, and I need you to meet the Messiah. I found him. We found the Messiah. I need you to come and meet the Messiah. He's Jesus from Nazareth. And Nathanael's like, what good can come out of Nazareth? And you know what Philip said? He said, just come and see. Just come and see. We closed out our study on the book of Revelation Wednesday night, and at the very end of the Revelation, chapter 22, I don't know, verse 17, somewhere in there maybe, he says that the Spirit and the bride say, come. They say, come. The Spirit is speaking to your heart, and if you know and you feel the Spirit moving in your heart and in your life, and you've never given your life to Christ, let me tell you what he's saying. He's saying, come. He's saying, come and take a drink. He's saying, come to the fountain of living waters and take a drink. Surrender your life to Christ. The bride also, and we know that the church, we are the church. We are the bride, and we are asking you, and we are inviting you, and we are telling you to come. Come and take a drink. Look, I had a lot more. I can close with this right here. There are many people who could tell, and again, to go back to how I started, sometimes it's really a struggle to explain to someone the difference that Christ has made. Here's what I can say, and here's what I know. And you ask anyone who is a Christian. I used to be one way, and now I am completely different. And the only thing that happened in between was Jesus. My cousin called me last night. He called me. I hardly talk to him ever. He called me last night. We talked for about an hour. I think he finally got around to it at the end. He asked me point blank. He said, what was it in your life that made you decide, hey, I need to kind of start getting my life together and I need to start getting it on track? And I paused for a little bit, thought about it, because I knew what he was asking me. But the answer is the truth. I said, Wendell, my life had always been on a path to destruction until I met Jesus. I didn't decide to turn my life around. I decided to take a drink from the fountain of living waters and let him see what he could do. That's what I decided. Would you come today? Would you surrender your life to Christ? He is the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into the world. He died on the cross as the payment for our sins. And he rose again the third day to show us that truly eternal life is in him. Come to him, believing and then surrendering, giving your life into his hands. Would you do that today? Stand up with me, if you would. What are we going to sing? I need thee every hour. Good, perfect song to sing during this. If you want to come and give your life, you know what? You can just come down here and you say, well, I don't know what to say. Here's what you say. Just tell me, I need to take a drink. That's all you got to tell me. I need to take a drink. And I'm going to lead you and we're going to pray together a prayer that's going to express what you already decided in your heart. There's nothing secret or magical about the prayer. It's just going to help express the decision that you're making in your heart. If you want to come and kneel and pray on your own, you come and do that. If you need to do anything today, you do it. If God is speaking to your heart, you don't even have to come to me. You don't even have to come down here. But if God is speaking to your heart today, do business with God. Better yet, let God do business with you. You come if you need to.